news. Rap star Christopher Rios died today from an apparent heart attack. As Big Pun, Mr. Rios became the first Latin hip-hop artist to achieve platinum status. At 26, he became the first Latin solo hip-hop artist to go platinum. At 28, he was dead. He is survived by his wife and three children.
At 26, he became the first Latin solo hip-hop artist to go platinum. At 28, he was dead.
There's a good and a bad side to everything. He could argue his way out of anything. He could sell sand in the desert. I mean, he was unbelievable. He was always writing. And he would come into the house and say rhymes, which it was hip hop at the time, but I had never heard of it. I didn't know what he was rambling. He would come in the house and go hip hop, hip to the hip hop. And I was like, what? What are you saying? You know, I'd go hit him in the face. What are you saying? You know, what are you talking about? He would start writing and you know, and play music and sing along with it and turn off the volume and make his own words to the rhymes. And I knew he was going to be someone very special.
Chris was hyper. Yeah, he wouldn't stay still. Hobbies, just sports and football and basketball. Chris loved basketball more than anything. He loved basketball.
I mean, he was funny. He always made me laugh. It's hard to make me laugh. I don't laugh too much. You know, I have a bitchy attitude somewhat, you know.
Everything was a joke, you know. He tried making people laugh. He made fun of people. He changed words to songs all the time. I mean,
he was just a clown. So every day we'll go to school and I'll see him and he'll just be like, you know, he'll be the type in the lunchroom, he'll pull up his sweats because he was always wearing sweats. So he'll pull up his sweats all the way up here. You know, then he'll run and he'll jump on the table and he'll just do all sorts of stupid shit. You know what I'm saying? Just making everybody laugh. Then, of course, we exchanged numbers and he would call me and we started on a little dating, you know, thing. I introduced him to my mom. My mom took a liking to him. And from there, we just started, you know, chilling every day together.
Christopher adored Liza.
April 8th was the first time that he was like, oh, can you be, you know, would you be my girl? That was when he popped the question. Will you be my girlfriend? April 8th of 1987. Obviously, I said yes.
He met Liza and he was head over heels with Liza. And Liza was younger than him. Not much younger, but she was young. They were, you know, they were 14 years old. So it wasn't something that you say, oh yeah, that's wonderful, that's great, you're gonna go get married, this, because they were kids, you know? So it was kind of like a puppy love, but it was much more than puppy love.
So I'm gonna pick me up by 7 o'clock in the morning. We'll be chilling, walking around all over the Bronx, you know what I'm saying? Going out to Westchester Avenue, going to Park Chester, back to Bronx River. Go over there by Watson, by the basketball court, play ball. It's like 7, 8 at night. So I would skip school. I wouldn't even go to school and just go home, chill. Next day in the morning, pick me up at 7, break out, just chill. We used to be some broke motherfuckers, have like $2. Sometimes nobody in the house would, yo, come upstairs, make him something to eat. I would have like $1, $2, buy like the big bakery bread, eat that, you know what I'm saying? But it was like nothing. We never stressed about money. We could have had $1 million. We could have had $1. It was all the same. For some reason, I don't know, I was like his whole world. You know what I'm saying? I was like his first real girlfriend. Not the first person he ever had sex with. I was his first girlfriend he ever had, like, you know, a girl his age. You know, he used to deal with, you know, crackheads and women and, you know, like grown women. You know what I'm saying? He used to deal in the street. You know what I'm saying? A lot. So he dealt with that. He never dealt with, you know, a girl. One time I went to his house. It was by 161st by the Yankee Stadium. His mom was like on drugs and she was living there with some accountant. But I didn't know the seriousness of like his, you know, his family, like his life, you know, like what was going on or anything like that. And I was young at 14, you know, you don't really ask them things or nothing like that.
I would say when Chris was a small child, when I did not have a problem with drugs, I was a nurturing mother. I was very close to my children. I did not know what drugs were at the time. And he had a loving family environment. Things changed when I became divorced from his father.
Chris loved my dad, and I loved my dad, but we weren't very close. My dad cheated on my mom, and my mom caught him.
I became single, and I started joining the single scene, and I experimented with drugs. Then I met Nicole's father. I stopped doing drugs at the time, but then about 2 years into the marriage, I realized he was on heroin. That's when I started. It was a great impact on my son because I couldn't be nourishing if I was on drugs. That's not the way I wanted it to be. I wanted to be a mother to him. But at the time, I didn't know how to deal with my pain.
And it was hard visiting my mom when Tommy was there. Tommy was very hard on Chris. He was, 11, I was 13, or even younger, you know. Throughout the years, I was, and I hate saying that I was never old enough to defend him because I should have. Even, you know, I should have did something, you know, said something. Tommy would wake up Chris in the middle of the night. I mean, we're sleeping in the room, and Tommy would just come in and get up, you know, and turn the lights on and make him get up and do push-ups and smack him in the back of his head. And I mean, he was just so harsh on him, you know? And I would just like, you know, I would be scared and I would shun myself in a corner. And Chris went through that when I saw it on the weekend, so I could only imagine what happened during the week, you know?
He always says how Tommy came and he just took an apple and from deep just threw it at him and hit him in the face, which, you know, the apple is like a rock.
I know my brother would get stressed out sometimes and he would punch holes in the wall and eat the rocks in the wall. I know, like I said, my father, I never with my father physically abusing him, but my father was hard on him, you know, always comparing him and stuff like that. He wanted him to be like a military boy. And you go to my brother's room, he have holes all over the wall, you know, that he just been eating because he been stressed out. It was his way of dealing with his anger at the time.
He had a terrible temper when he was young. He would get so red. I mean, so red that I think this kid is going to burst. And then he would clench his teeth. And he started biting mugs. And that as it got bigger, it was more rocks, bigger rocks. And I tell him, that's going to mess up your inside. Crystal, you can't be eating rocks. It was rocks and ice. And he would just crush. Got to have teeth made of steel. And it was a bad habit. We couldn't do anything about it. Because not me, he would never tell me going to get rocks for him. But he had Liza getting all this stuff. And she couldn't. I wasn't, wouldn't. But she couldn't say no.
My father supposedly approached Tommy, but Tommy denied it all, and my mom denied it all. But my mom had a problem back then. She had an addiction that didn't allow her to be a better mom. So she didn't defend Chris.
He used to tell me he used to live in Fordham. He was like 7, 8 years old, going by himself to pay Con Edison, which is crazy. I got my son 8 years old. I can't never picture him like, yeah, go take this bill across the Bronx and pay a bill, you know what I'm saying, by yourself. He went through a lot of hunger, a lot of, you know, not being dressed properly, not having proper shoes.
My brother had a really tough, tough life.
Sometimes he did things he wasn't supposed to do. He spent one night in jail, and that's all it took, was that one night, and he said he was never gonna go to jail again.
That's the worst thing that could happen to anybody, any parent, to see your grandson or child or whatever in handcuffs. I didn't know what to do. I remember when he was arrested, he had this big bomber, leather jacket, and all these fancy rings, and chained down to here, and he thought he was the man, you know. That's when I found out he was selling drugs. On the way home, I tell him, Chris, I can't go to this. How could you be selling drugs at your age? You know, what are you doing? And he looked at me, he said, I will never get arrested, ever. I will never let you go through that again. And then I said, where's all that fancy stuff you have? He says, no, they took it. I guess you have to hand all this stuff in. And they're going to keep it. I'll never come back. Never, because I'm never going to spend another night in there.
Then he got tired. He was telling his mother that he didn't want to sell any more drugs. And he didn't want to do that anymore. So she told him, well, if you don't sell any more drugs, then you got to leave. So she actually kicked him out because he didn't want to sell him more drugs.
Chris was house to house looking for a place to sleep. For a little while, he went to stay with, I have an older sister, Christine. He went to stay with her mom, Linda. And Linda took him in and he ate a lot. And she said, oh my God, you know, Christopher eats so much and, you know, it's so hard. But, you know, she says, well, you know, you feed three, you feed four, you know, no big deal. And that's how pretty much Chris was for a while. He was just going where he could sleep and where he can get a meal, and it was like that for a while. Chris loved my mom. You know, my mom was not the best mom. All he ever wanted was for her to love him back the way that he loved her. That's all Chris wanted. He wanted our mom to love him. That's all. I believe my brother felt that he had no other choice but to do that, to help her. You know, and she looked at it, I think, as if, you know, he was hurting her, but he was helping her. I think maybe Christopher felt that when he put her there, that it would change her and make her a better person, get her off the drugs, and she would become a better mom. I think that's what Chris's goal was. I think that's what he wanted. That's what he expected.
I had a relapse, and I had to enter a methadone program, which was very difficult for Chris because I was having problems with Leo, with his drug abuse, and I was trying to pull out of that. I didn't want to be caught up in that anymore, but I did relapse, and I realized that I had to get rid of him if my life was going to turn around, if I was going to be any use to my family and be the mother that I needed to be.
I was in Puerto Rico. I remember hearing that she was sent to Long Island because they wanted to separate them. And then after I came back from Puerto Rico, then, you know, I met him, but I knew him in the context of the bochinche. So he was basically like, ooh, the boy that likes my sister, and they're trying to get him away from her. And then after that, he didn't have a place to stay. He was basically homeless. He was 14, 15 years old, and he was homeless. And so my mother took him in. It was like more of like, ay bendito, like compassion towards him because he was like, you know, so young and he was in the street and he had nowhere to go. And then basically he became like a little brother and he lived with us. But he never really stayed around in the house. He would leave early in the morning. He would go play basketball and then he would come back late at night. Like he didn't want to be in the way. He had that, I think he had that embarrassment that he didn't have a place to stay, that we opened the doors to him and he didn't want to be like a burden. I remember he used to come and eat something and he would want to wash his dish immediately, like if he was a guest.
I saw him one day and he was like, what's up? You know what I'm saying? You back? You know what I'm saying? Let's go out. I was like, nah, I'm chilling. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to do nothing. I don't want to get in trouble because it hurt me. It was hard for me to live out there for a year and a half in Long Island. You know what I'm saying? Because I wasn't close to my father. And it was a whole year and a half that I was away from my mother. And I was like forbidden to come to the Bronx. So then he bounced to Florida for like a month just on vacation. And he had left his number with my mother. So I'm doing my thing and whatever. And he already bounced to Florida. And then my mother had came and she said, yo, Chris gave me his number. I'm like, all right, whatever. So I just left it there. A month, 2 months passed, and she's like, oh, what's up? You called him? I'm like, nah. So now my mother's stressing me if I called him. I'm like, nah, you know, I ain't calling, whatever. So then one day I called him, and we stood on the phone like, I don't know. I must have had like mad quarters or something. We stood on the phone mad long. He came the next day, the next day he came to see me. I remember exactly what he was wearing. Some blue jeans with a Gap shirt, the classic, you know, Reeboks. And I'm like, you know, I hear him calling me outside the window. I'm like mad nervous, like, oh my God, you know, he's here. And I'm like getting dressed and getting ready and shit. Then I come downstairs and it was like we wasn't never gone. We was never separated for that whole year and a half. You know what I'm saying? We hooked up like that. His grandmother at that time, she was also going to Florida. So he was supposed to go back out there with her. But then since we hooked up, so then he decided he didn't want to go back to Miami.
And then he said, Abuela, but I have a girl named Liza. I said, you know how many girls are in this world? There's girls in Miami too, believe it or not. There's girls all over. No, but that's my first girl. That's my honey, right? I said, okay, Chris. But we're still going to Florida. So I started making arrangements. And when he saw that it was serious and everything is packing and they're taking the furniture, we're leaving the next day. And he tells me, I'm not going to Florida. I'm going to make whatever he was going to make of his life, I'm going to make it here. He says, Abuela, you have to know, I'm going to be 18 in 2.5 weeks. Please don't make me go, and please don't call the authorities. If I force him, with all the problems this child has had in his life, and of the relationship that we had as a grandmother, I said, I cannot ruin whatever is up here in his mind.
One day I found out I was homeless, and I was like, but how every day you come and clean? And, you know, he was like, nah, you know, sometimes I stay in my friend's house. I'll take a shower, change there. He said, I have my clothes stash in this building. He had this clothes stash in this abandoned building in the Bronx over there in Intervale by whole place. right? And there was like a light with a pump. He said sometimes I just wash up in the pump or, you know, crazy stuff. I was like, wow, you know, say that's crazy. So then I had a little money saved up, and me and my mom, we went and we got him a furnished room at Hunts Point. So then he got a furnished room at Hunts Point. Then from there, he started bumping trucks at Hunts Point for money. So one day he came and he called his lawyer, and he was like, his lawyer had been in his family like for 40-some years. So he called the lawyer, and he was like, yeah, you know, Gertzog, you ain't got any money to, you know, he called him to like borrow some money because he was like really fucked up. The lawyer was like, oh my God, Chris, I've been, where you been? I've been like looking for you, you know what I'm saying? You settled this case. Because when he was like 4 or 5 years old, he fell off a building in Clinton Towers in Manhattan. They were doing some construction in the park, and he climbed up a couple of stories up, and he fell, which caused his ankle to break off. So the mother put a lawsuit, and they never settled it until he was 18. So by the time he was 18, they settled, and he had like $500,000. So he was like, oh my God, you know what I'm saying? He was paid. He got this 18-year-old kid. He got like $500,000. So he went over there to the lawyer. He got a, you know, advance, a couple of G's or whatever. So he came through with like mad coats, and, you know, he had his rope chain. And he came with me a leather jacket, had a leather trench, his black jacket. One day we riding on the train. And he came and he asked me, we had like 3 G's, 4 G's in our pocket. He was like, yo, you wanna go get this apartment? And already at this time, my mother was being real a hard ass, so she gave me a curfew, like by 7, I had to be in my house, or if not, she was gonna throw me out. So I was like, you know. So then he was like, yo, let's get this apartment. So I was like, yeah, but if I got this apartment, I gotta get this like tonight, because if I'm not home by 7, then I'm gonna get thrown out. Like, I was stressed, you know what I'm saying? Like, yo, she gonna throw me out, whatever, whatever. So I bet. So we went all the way to 2:30 something up in White Plains, and went to this little Blake Realty, and we saw this Jamaican guy who was like, yo, we gotta get a crib, you know what I'm saying? We gotta get it like today, tonight. And Pum was like putting the mad pressure, like, no, but you know what I'm saying? I got a couple of places, you know, you get, so he's like, no, tonight, we gotta get a place tonight. So we got our first crib right there, 221st and White Plains. We paid for the down payment, went to the place. It had no light or nothing yet, you know what I'm saying? And then like 2 months later, we got married in May 5th. We did the whole city hall thing because who was gonna invite to a wedding? It's not like we didn't have money for a wedding. But his family was against him marrying me. My mother wasn't happy about me getting married. So like, who were we gonna invite? You know what I'm saying? We were just doing it for us. So I went to the city hall, we got our license. I went with his wedding gown and we had the tux, we had the limo. We did it up though in the city hall. We was doing it up. You know what I'm saying? I only got one photo. You know, the guy that paid the $5 photo, that's the only photo I have for my wedding. And from there we got in, you know, we did the whole wedding thing. My father came through, you know what I'm saying? Cause he had to sign me off cause I was a minor, and my father looked like he was dying. He came with his security guard outfit, you know what I'm saying, uniform. He was not even trying to be there. My mother, she looked like they just stabbed in the back a couple of times. Chris's mother, Gail, she was there for a witness. She was not happy. She was just loving it because everybody else was stressed out, and I guess she loved to see everybody else stressed out. So she was just like flaunting, like, yeah, my son getting married, like, you know, whatever. We did our thing. We bounced. We went to a hotel for a night. That was a little honeymoon. We went stood in the Marriott Marquis for one night. We ate dinner. We chilled, and we was back at the crib the next day.
We used to sit in the kitchen table. He used to like to play Scrabble, and he used to beat me all the time. He always used to be like, oh, you're in college, and I could beat you, because she was very smart. And he would just, like, throw the tiles on the board, and wherever it would land, he'd say, okay, that's a word. And we used to say, I challenge you. And when you would go in, it would be a word. And then sometimes, and he was actually very good at building on the words that you had already put. So he would always try to build on a word that I put, and I would be bragging, okay, 36 points, ha, ha, ha. Then he would take either a suffix or a prefix or add something, and then it was 100 points. And I think that carried on to then his music. He could talk about all kinds of subjects. He wasn't the type of person that was on the street but was ignorant. He knew about politics. He knew about the weather. He knew about, you know, anything that had to do with the world. I mean, he could have a conversation about anything.
Sage introduced me to Pun. Came in front of my window, said, what's up? You know, I knew Sage before Pun. And that was my man. And he was always with the rap thing. And I was always with the rap thing, but on the hobby tip, on the low, nobody, you know, I was shy. And, you know, we met each other like Triple Sage was my man like that. And he came to my window, said, what's up? You know, he had this kid with him. You know, he had a Carhartt suit walking up and down. you know, can't stay and stay. So I was like, what's up, baby? I'll be down in a minute. I came downstairs. I met Chris. You know what I'm saying? I used to call him Moondog. And, you know, from the first day, he just was mad cool. Cool dude. Show love. He just showed love. He just had like to have fun. Everything he said was just funny. You know what I'm saying? This nigga just was it. It was the total package from the beginning.
So we met on the basketball court on my block. He was real slim, like, you know what I mean? He was like a buck 80 at that time. And he was never back then, like, he was good at anything. Like, anything he put his mind to, he'd be good at it. That's how he was. But I was the only one rapping back then. Home was more into, like, Surface and Luther Van. He had that soul in him, that harmonizer. He could do a song. He used to write songs and shit like that. And then that nigga just, you know, he just changed it over and made it to rap.
He start coming up with things just like, you know, kids do it up in the suburbs, you know what I'm saying? You start putting up a band together. It was just like me and him. And we all, you know, we both liked to rap and we love hip hop. And he used to love music. That was his thing, music. Me, I used to just write hip hop in class, you know? And then we got together, we started saying, yo, we rhyme. We started not, you know, I started realizing how nice he was. Then he said the same thing about me, and then it was just like, yo, let's just make a little group and see how far we could take it. But, you know, some play shit, some kid shit. And we did, you know, it was rough and rugged, then it was total package. Then Sace always used to rhyme, so Sace was having a little problems with his group that he was doing it. You know, something happened there, and, you know, Sace was like a free agent, so we added him to the group. So that's why we became Full Eclipse.
Full Eclipse is what started everything. That's our foundation. That's where Pun really came from. That's where Cuban really came from. Sace, me. When we had Full Eclipse, it was straight up family. I can't even say had because we still here, just minus one. You know, God bless. When I think of Full Eclipse, I think about the car, two-door car, all of us in it, Pun. I think about the pellet guns and us bugging out, shooting out windows. I think about when we was hungry, me, Pun, Cuban, and Sace. No money, no food. We used to go park across the street from Kentucky Fried Chicken. You know what I mean? And wait for the cat with the biggest bag to walk out of there. And you see the cat walk out with the biggest bag, I'll deliver.
Then as time went by, it started like they started getting more serious. You know what I'm saying? They started coming to the house more, started riding more. 1993 is when they became Full Eclipse.
Then the politics started getting involved as far as we want to get a deal. So obviously, Pun standing out heavy, you know what I mean? Big. He's a big guy. He's moving. He's jumping off of stages. His lyrics is unbreakable. So maybe like, Flex was like telling Joe, yo, these niggas from the block. I'm on, man.
Joe wasn't even trying to even listen to us. Like,
Not at all.
It was a regular thing, you know what I'm saying? As far as like people coming up to him saying, no, I rap. And he kick raps and he just blows them off because he's like, yeah, you know, I'm doing my thing, whatever. So it was just like that when he first saw us. You know what I'm saying? We, you know, had to be like the inner crew had to really put it to his face.
Yeah,
like that.
His inner crew.
His inner crew, which was, you know, guys like Flex,
Little Hack,
you know what I'm saying? That was like, yo, these niggas is nice.
First, I heard about Pun through my projects, through Little Hack and Flex. Everybody kept telling me that, you know, it was these Spanish kids that was rhyming, and it was so hard as me as a Spanish nigga to get on where I was like, you know, damn, another Spanish group or whatever the case may be. And so one day I'm driving, one of them weird days that I'm driving by myself and I stop in front of the store and I see these niggas rhyming and shit. So I go in there and get my little Diet Pepsi and I come outside and all of a sudden Pun is like, yo, let me rhyme. First I look at him, I'm like, damn, this nigga's a big nigga right here. So then he started rhyming. He was like, blow the sun away. Me and my niggas play hardball, strictly hardcore. But when I heard him, I was just like crazy, like, oh my God, like, yo, this thing is incredible. Like, I couldn't believe it. I remember that night, I didn't even sleep. I was like, just bugging. Like, the next day, I called him up. I was just finishing off Jealous One's Envy, my album. And he came to the studio and I was doing that record, the dedication. So then we had this one joint that I was putting on me, getting on. And I put him on immediately, the next day. Like, I would never do that, not now. Not never would I just, you know, meet somebody and put him on my album the next day. So I knew he was that nice. And at the time, I knew nobody could fuck with him. The nigga was multi-talented. Like, even a lot of niggas just is talented hardcore-wise. A lot of niggas have a bigger vision, and they can make songs that, you know, are hits, mainstream hits. So I knew I could actually take it there, you know what I mean, which is incredible.
Out of nowhere, Fat Joe walks in with this big dude, you know, I swear they look like twins, which is obviously why that came about down the line. And, you know, Joe was like, yo, this dude can spit, he's ill. He came in with the stocking cap on his head, you know, and he said he's Big Punisher. And just the look alone, he looked like what he, you know, what he was going to sound like. We didn't get to him spit yet because J. Rue was hogging the mic and so was Big Jazz. Because, of course, they're trying to break their record. And this dude has no deal. And he hops in, says, let me just kick one verse. And everybody steps aside. And he just completely just shatters the mic, you know, where I was just so stunned. I was like, man, he going to get a deal.
And from there, you know what I'm saying, they were still doing the Full Eclipse for a while. You know what I'm saying? But Joe was really feeling him. And then the Full Eclipse itself was having little problems here and there. Shit wasn't jumping off. So I just told him, so, you know, you're going to get, you know, Joe's willing to sign you, you know what I'm saying? Just do your thing. You put your peoples on. So that's how it started with that.
I just told Pun, yo, you the best one. You got to do what you got to do. We get you on. And then, you know what I'm saying, you turn around and we put your mans on. That was always the goal. That was always the focus. As a group, they were rhyming about stuff that, you know, really wasn't gonna pop off. They was rhyming about devil-type worshiping and all kind of crazy shit. I knew that he understood and he had the talent it took to become a star. So, of course, we got Pun on it. He was happy because not everybody could get on. So he was on it. We put them on records and we let them ride and be on the videos and do everything and just roll with us. And we finally, after Pun Pop, I got Terror Squad Records. I signed Cuban and Sace, you know, as a, like, you know, we was gonna work with them, you know what I'm saying? And we was just gonna put them on and put their records out because that was a promise that Pun had made them.
If one thing I know about Fat Joe, he's a businessman, you know what I mean? So I feel he saw the opportunity. This is a cat that's hot. He on the rise, he repping the Bronx, he got style, he got delivery. And, you know, let me jump on this.
I remember when he came one day, he was like, oh, I met Fat Joe. You know what I'm saying? And I was like, who's Fat Joe? You know what I'm saying? He's like, oh, you know, what's that song that he had? I got a flow, Joe. And he's telling, you know, the guy that he sings, I got a flow, Joe, I got a flow. I'm like, word, who's watching videos all the time? Like, you know, that him, the, you know, the Boricua cat. I'm like, word, that's cool, you know, whatever, whatever. Then I remember he came to the house. That was the first time I met him, and they chilled, they talked. And from there, we just have meetings on and off. And he would, like, break out with him, you know, on shows and tours. And then from one day to another, you know what I'm saying, he told me that he was getting signed, which, you know, he wasn't, I don't remember the exactly specific day when he came, yeah, I'm getting signed, you know what I'm saying? But I just remember always Chris being in work mode. He was always writing. He was always with ideas.
Me, personally, I was growing. Like, I did Ashacha. I put him in the video. All my videos, Hustling is the Key to Success and all that. I had Pun in the videos. I was doing remixes for my songs like Wishful Thinking with Be Real, Coogee Rap. I would throw Pun on. Like, everything I would do, I would throw Pun on. Like, you know what I'm saying? Just so that people could start knowing who Pun is. You know what I'm saying? Just bring them out there like that. Before Biggie had died, I had Politic. I was going to do a song with Biggie and Pun. That's all I was trying to do, was trying to get his notoriety out there. At the same time, all the shows we was doing, he was, you know, hyping up. He was with me. He used to hate that because before they knew who he was Pun, he'd come on stage and they'd scream like if he's Fat Joe. And we made a deal that I go on stage first. And he's not trying to have them screaming at him as Fat Joe. And what's so unique about Pun is that no one knew who he was, and he ripped the fucking show. Like, you know, that's very rare. Like, artists nowadays, you need a hit record for them to rip a show. Like, Pun, with nobody knowing him, would just rip it down wherever we was at, North Carolina, South Carolina, wherever we was at. He was just special, you know what I'm saying? There ain't too many special people like that.
Pun brought to Terror Squad another side. Terror Squad, if you listen to Joe's first album and second album, straight street gutter shit. And with the ill production to back that up. Pun brought something else to the table. He brought the extra oomph. He took it to the ladies. He took it to the lyrical cats. He took it to the radio. Pun got on that album at the last minute. Joe's album was already good. So it'd have been a fight if Joe would have still been fighting for his attention. By Pun coming in, repping TS, he took the TS thing to the next level because TS already had the respect.
There's no doubt about it. You know, Pun was the shit. I mean, Joe was the hustling Don, you know. Pun came and was the missing piece to not only Joe's puzzle, but to the hip-hop puzzle. So just by Pun getting down with Joe, it saved everything. It saved him.
Joe was his manager. Joe was the guy who talked for Pun when it came to like big meetings with Steve Rifkin and all that, all the big dogs. Joe was his voice. And Joe's voice became more powerful after Pun kept delivering his hits. It was a perfect team. It was just a perfect team between them two in business. But it didn't even out when it came to Pun's wants. Even though Pun wanted a lot of things, Pun deserved it. Pun made millions of dollars for people. Pun kept a lot of people alive to this day, kept their reputation alive, kept their name alive, made people feel proud of themselves, built this whole shit. This is Pun's idea, right? That we living out.
Oh, that was his brother, man. That was, you know, that's what it is, man. That was one right there, them two. It was one, you know what I mean? And like I said, you know, that's all I knew is every time I seen him, I knew he was right there with him. It goes the same way. So, you know, far as them being, like I said, celebs to me, it wasn't like that. I looked at the niggas just like, yo, that's family right there. Shit, if it was a little baby argument, we all would laugh about it, you know what I mean?
Business and friendship, you're gonna have some clashing with each other. And I've seen Joe and Pun have their clashes with each other, but still, they didn't let it show to the public or to the industry, and the records didn't stop, you know, coming out a certain way. They still came out the way Pun liked to put it out. You know what I'm saying? And the one thing I liked about that is, again, I fought many a times with my partner, but at the same time, we always let the music overpower any differences between us. And they showed the same signs of that.
My job was to take care of Pun and make sure that nothing happens to him, make sure that nobody takes advantage of him, make sure that he wouldn't go to jail for a million years, because he definitely could have been a candidate for going to jail for a million years. He had a far belief on reality. You know what I'm saying? This guy would be walking around with 10 guns. 10 guns gives you 30 years in jail. So I was also, you know, the big brother that would nag him. You know what I'm saying? So I can remember a bunch of times when, you know, I used to go to his house and throw everybody out of his house and just be like, yo, get the fuck out of his house. And, you know, Pun, he'd just be like, yo, you know, y'all got to go, you know. And you know what I'm saying? So he would do a lot of stuff. I'm more careful. I'm a lot more careful and aware of what could happen if you do certain things. But Pun, he really, really didn't care. Wasn't scared of the cops, wasn't scared of this, wasn't scared of that. And that used to scare me that he wasn't scared of nothing.
Can't be pussy. That's it. Yeah. He did not want to look like he was pussy at all, and nobody anywhere. He'd do whatever. He didn't care how many platinum records he sold. I mean, he summed it up in one interview one time the best. He said, you know, he said, what you got to understand about me? He said, I'm a man about pride. He said, you know, you can do this to me, you can do that, but as soon as you disrespect me, you know, I'll kill a nigga. I don't care. He said, I'll kill him. And I would spend my whole life in jail, probably crying every night. You know that, but the fact that you disrespect me won't stop me from killing you.
I remember he was out with Joe or something riding around, and it came on the radio. And he had called me to pay attention to the radio that was going to come on. And he called me. He was like, oh, how do I sound? You know, I was like, you know, his voice, it sounds different than, you know, on the radio, you know what I'm saying? His voice than him talking to you in person. But I was happy. I was like, yo, it's how hot, you know, say it was good. He was excited. He was good. You know what I'm saying? He was happy about it.
Because he, me and him sat down. I was, one day he told me, do you think I'm going to go gold? And me, as being a rookie too, you know what I'm saying? We had a lot, I had a lot of guys like G-Rap, you know, I came with the Juice Crew, all them niggas are nice in the game. And I was like, dog, you probably sell like $300,000.
You got to remember that shit. That ain't
what I'm saying. $100,000 to me is great too. But I didn't know how the business was railing. You go $500,000, that's gold, and all that. So I another shit, $300. That's in the middle of $100. You know, you can't lose. You're in the middle. You get another shot when you sell $300. So he fucking flipped on me. He was like, crazy. I'm going to fucking go.
We were so excited. He called and he was like, I did a video. You know, you've got to see it. It's coming on in such and such time. And, you know, I think, you know, we were all glued to our TVs when that video was coming on. And we were so excited. And right there, I said, oh, my God, my brother is so talented. He's so smart. I mean, I always knew he was, you know, he had it in him. But it came to life, you know. My brother was on TV.
I wouldn't be surprised if Pun held the record for the most amount of appearances on other people's projects within such a short time span. Bun must have did like 24 within a year and a half's time of other people calling him to get on their record. Pun finally got Latinos, a huge demographic in hip hop, been there since day one, a voice. You know, it's like Pun fucking catered to the blacks, to the whites, to the Latinos. Pun made it hip to use the cha-cha beats. It was like around that time, even Eve had a hit record around that time with the what dun dun da dun dun dun. Little albums here and there started popping up with little, hey, let's do this for the Spanish people joints. That was because of Pun.
Pun was just incredible, man. Just like, you know, he was too fast for me. Too fast for anyone. He's a dude that could have done 10 hours. He could have did the Tupac. You know what I'm saying? He could have did the Tupac all day, double albums, triple albums. Cause you know, he was writing constantly. He sort of did it when he did so many songs with different people. But his worth ethic in the studio, you know, it's different times, man. Different times with different mode. Sometimes Pum wouldn't even want to be around. He felt like you was forcing him to be on the song. He would come for 10 minutes, spit his verse, leave. Sometimes he would be in there where you couldn't get him out of the studio for days, sleeping in that motherfucker. He was just had different modes, you know what I mean? It was all on Pun, you know what I mean? Pun was going to decide whatever he wanted to make happen.
He was as great as, you know, how people look at Rakim and they look at Nas and they look at, you know, Coogee Rap and Tupac and Big. He was like that with his first album, you know what I mean? A lot of people don't really notice that. Like, you know, Big had two albums, Pac had about 57, you know what I mean? But Pun did a lot of that shit with his first album.
He was saying real shit in his rhymes. He wasn't coming up with no mythology shit. This is shit he felt when he was going through, you know what I mean? A lot of people don't really listen to Pun, man. Pun is one of the greatest fucking rappers ever. First album I played with anybody, Pac, Biggie, anybody. Lyrics, they don't got his lyrics. They don't got it. Not the way he put it together. Never. It's just common sense.
Charisma, compounds, metaphor, punchlines, everything. It's flow, delivery, everything was so.
Maybe they recognize it, you know what I mean? Maybe they won't, but I know his beats. For me, it'll always be the best, you know what I mean?
Yo le daría la posición ahora mismo. Entre las primeras posiciones todavía, porque sus dos primeros años no fueron blancos. ¿Sabes? Él siempre iba a ser la cara y seguirá siendo la cara de la primera cara latina en representar tan grandemente. ¿Sabes? Todos los latinos que oyen hip hop, que son fanáticos de hip hop, sabíamos que Pun era el ídolo.
There's nobody fucking with that dude. Even lyrically to this day, it's like some of these dudes can't do what he did. The way he put them words together. The way he picked, you know, the punchlines. His character, his wit, his charisma. All of that in one makes for one of the greatest rappers of all time. Period.
I did a lot of shows with Pun. And like I said, it was like, you could see that the women loved him. And like I said, Joe said to me, I've done a lot of hardcore records, but this go round with Pun, we're seeing a whole different audience, man. We're seeing the women, we're seeing a whole different type of love. I saw, you know, women jumping up and down for this cat. And that was just a crazy experience in itself.
He definitely put a bar that you gotta raise to if you're gonna be that. If you're gonna be an MC, Latin MC, competing black music, Pun is the bar.
And it's like a lot of cats doubted him. And I don't even know if it's on some Spanish shit, but you know, it's hard for us anyway in this game as it is. So for a cat like him that was doing what he was doing, it was incredible.
But the first time I didn't know it was gonna get that big. I mean, it caught me by surprise, even though I knew he was gonna make a name, but for it to take off and to really, really get the support of not just the hip hop community, but the Latino community definitely supported him and put them basically as their mayor.
The buzz was there, man. You kinda knew. You kinda knew because he did the 50 MCs with me before the album dropped. So when I got to work with him that day and actually be in the whole vocal booth and working together, that's after that day I knew he was a monster. You know what I mean?
A la misma vez pues, creó un puente y de que verdad todos los latinos y los americanos se fijaran en los boricuas y que nosotros estábamos aquí.
He did Beware for the street niggas. He did Super Lyrical with Black Thought, who at the time, you know, even to this day, is semi-untouchable when it comes to rhyming, freestyling off the head. And Pun gave him a run for his money. That's one thing. Pun was always on some more. If I do a track with somebody, it's to eat him up. Ain't nobody beating me on the track, you know what I'm saying? Which explains a lot of his sick-ass verses on other niggas' tracks.
How can I deny it? I had to sit in the studio and say, whoa, I gotta step my shit up. Because he's coming for everybody's head right now. Pun gets a 10. He's at the top of the line. As far as where he sits in my, you know, category, I mean, I put him with the greatest. I put him with Biggie. I put him with Pac. I put him with Melly Mel and Rakim. And because he came out in this quick, this time, and you knew it was real serious. You know what I mean? It wasn't like, there's a lot of rappers out that they're going to be out for another 3 years, and I'm not going to take them serious. As soon as Pun came, you know the ones who's the truth. You know it straight off the bat, and he was one of them.
He was the first real Latin, real Boricua to go platinum in this rap business. It let us know that there was love out there for us. It let us know that we could go platinum. That lifts the self-esteem of an entire nation, of an entire Latin nation.
See, Pun is one of the dudes that valued the true essence of the game. And how could he not still be a player? He's not in it to be MC Hammer. He wasn't in it to be one of these fake niggas, you know what I mean? Pun kept it gritty, I'm saying? So, and you could tell that with his rhymes. You could tell the shit he knew about, the shit he was talking about in his music. The niggas loved hip hop. So, I mean, he's always gonna be that player.
The game sucks. A lot of dudes don't really emphasize on the MCing aspect or even the lyrical aspect. They just rap. Pun put thought into his music. You know, Pun kept niggas on their toes. You know, Pun would have hip hop fans like, yo, did you hear what he said? You know, and he's so needed right now. So needed right now. There's not that many people are doing it the way he did it.
He set off a trend. Remember that. First Latino nigga to go platinum. That's extra real right there. And that shit go worldwide. You know what I mean? That shit go all the way around the world.
Let me tell you something. Anybody who changed the complexion of the game deserves a spot in rap history. And he made Latino rap from Puerto Ricans legitimate. And that's something that no one can take away.
I remember when he went gold, he felt good. It was like he did it. He accomplished something, you know what I'm saying? Then it went went platinum real quick. And from there, it went double platinum quick. You know what I'm saying? It was just work, you know what I'm saying? It was just shows rolling in, you know? It was all over the place, all over the world. We did tours. Went to Amsterdam, everywhere in LA, we was just everywhere. But he was excited. He was just like, No, his head got bigger. I'm not going to front, you know what I'm saying? His head got a little big. But he just got big with certain people. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't just every, he didn't act big like that, big-headed with everybody. It was just with certain people. He acted big-headed.
When he became Pun, his whole ego changed. And I just saw myself as Nairi, not as his sister. Just as a girl, as a person. You know what I'm saying? He was always like, that's my sister, you know, full respect, whatever. But other than that, we weren't as close as I wish we should have been.
When Pun went platinum and we threw a platinum party and how we all was just jumping up and down with the plaque, I put him out, but at the same time, we grew together. So a lot of shit that he was going through, I ain't never been through, like as far as, you know, getting big like that. So we are, next thing I know, we rented mansions and we going to the Grammys. You know what I'm saying? And we got our suits on and we fronting like we do this every day. You know what I'm saying? We like, whatever, we here now. What?
Chris, wouldn't it be great if you were nominated for a Grammy? You know, have you heard anything yet? And he said at that moment, hold on a minute, I have another phone call. And then all of a sudden I hear like yelling in the background and screaming. And he comes back on the phone. He goes, that was the phone call. I just got nominated. And we went out there, we stood out there like for a month in LA. We had this big ass mansion, stood out there for a while. And then once we got, it was the day, the actual day of the Grammys. You know what I'm saying? He had a high ass outfit on, you know, we all dressed up, you know, he's all iced out. I did his hair and everything. Got in a limo, broke out, went over there. And it was weird because it's like, I always watch the Grammys on TV, you know what I'm saying? And to watch people walk down the red strip, the red carpet, you know what I'm saying? And they're, you know, and you know, I was like, wow, it must be cool to be there one day. And I was actually there, you know what I'm saying? And I remember just walking into the crowd and just, you know, he was walking, I was a few steps behind him, you know what I'm saying? And then, you know, and I just see everybody cheering for him. It was like crazy. And he was just walking down that aisle and it was like, and I was like, wow, it's crazy because we would sit all the time and watch, you know, the Grammys and the awards, you know, year after year. And that was, and that's when it dawned on me, like, wow, I never thought that he would be here at this time.
Big dream was to do that Cheeto Trinidad fight against De La Hoya, which was one of the biggest things we ever did in our lives. Well, most prideful things is going up out there with Cheeto Trinidad. Trinidad hit him with the gloves when we was in the ring. It was just like a movie. I know we made a lot of people proud.
Wow. I mean, Pun, he loved when he was invited to come rap at the Felix Trinidad fight. That was it. You know, that was the day that he considered himself a legend. And I remember that Joe told him, we're not legends yet. And Pun was like, no, we are. We're legends, bro.
Big Pun was a great husband. I mean that's the bottom line. You know, his wife stood with $10,000 in her pocket. She stood with a new car. If it wasn't a Benz, it was a truck. You know, he had it in houses.
I hope I could love somebody the way he loved my sister. You know, besides someone who's family. He loved my sister to death. I honestly, he'll do anything. He did anything for my sister. He, no matter, before the rapping, before all that bullshit, there was always, you know, he was there. He supported 100%, you know. He could have easily blown up and peace, you know what I'm saying? I'll find some dumb bitch to do everything for me too, you know. That's easy to do. Nah, he stuck it through. Those were his kids. He loved his kids and my sister. That was one thing I knew for sure. That's one thing I could never deny him.
Pun was a great father and always had his kids around him. There's no way he would go without his kids. Certain things I don't know about, you know what I'm saying? He always took care of them kids. You know, those are the only kids you see with a fucking four-wheeler truck with a rims and system and TVs on them. I mean, them kids right there done lived out some dreams. My kids haven't seen what they seen. Their father was renting mansions, was being in hotel suites bigger than the world. You know what I'm saying? They lived like a crazy ill life, man, at a young age. They seen a lot of shit, and he always had them with him.
He had an obsession with Vanessa's lips. You know, he was constantly trying to kiss her lips and he was always grabbing her and squeezing her cheek and grabbing her lips. He loved, you know, his kids so much. He constantly wanted to be with his children.
He gave them everything. We gave them everything that they could have, stuff that we didn't have. You know what I'm saying? Because we ain't grew up with anything. You know what I'm saying? Whatever they wanted, they got. He used to say to teach them to defend themselves. You know what I'm saying? It was a discipline thing. You know, if they argue or they fight or they used to not, like, behave the proper way, he would never spank them, but he would make them box each other, which that would drive the kids crazy.
He would wake them up at, like, 3 a.m. to make them box. And I'm like, hello, you know, they're sleeping. Liza, wake up the kids. Liza would go upstairs and get the kids and bring them down, and he'd put their gear on, and he'd make them be knocking each other out.
Pun's son or something would be crying or whatever, and he'll tell the son, yo, go put on the gloves. And tell his daughter, go put on the gloves, and just have them thumping. You know what I mean? This way, they, you know, that's real. That's real shit right there. You know what I mean? Because a lot of kids grow up, and 9 times out of 10, your mother is babies you. My son falls on the floor. You don't hear nobody going, ooh, ah, because my son falls on the floor. I get, motherfucker, get the fuck back up. You know what I mean? And people who don't do that, a lot of times, their kids grow up to be soft individuals, and that's the one thing I respect about Pun as a family man, is that he taught his kids self-defense, and not just the boys, them girls, too. You know what I mean? The girls is up there swinging their fists, too. And that's something real important to me, you know what I mean? Because a lot of kids go out there, and they get hurt, and, you know, things of that, and it lowers their self-esteem. So that's a great reflection for me, from my point of view, of a great family man that Pun was, you know what I mean?
You know, you see how tough they are now, that's because Pun got them tough. You know what I mean? He disciplined his kids, he showed them what it's gonna be like. His daughter fucking to knock you out right now, you know, it's the bottom line right now, you know what I'm saying? You might beat up little Chris, his daughter will knock you the fuck out right now. So as a father, I think he was a beautiful father. As far as I know, Big Pun was a great father. Wow.
As far as in the house, it was a rule that you couldn't fall asleep. Whoever was the first person to fall asleep, you was risking yourself of getting wet.
We invented a game called, well, he invented it, but I named it. It's called Wet Dreams. And he just, you know, you see you go to sleep, you're chilling, you're 5 a.m, you're drunk, and then you just smash you with a bottle of water and, you know, cold ice, so you could almost catch a heart attack when you wake up. Well, that's his games, to the extreme. You know, so fun. We caught it on cameras.
This is Big Play with Wet Dreams on Channel Dick in Your Mouth, www.dickinyourmouth.com.
We went to All Star Cafe, so we all sitting at the booth and shit, whatever. So Tone's man goes to the bathroom and shit, so he leaves his phone on top of the table and shit. Hey, yo, that shit was mad funny. The whole afternoon, Pun was fucking around going like this, like under his stomach and putting that shit in niggas' faces so they could smell that shit. Yo, that shit smelled like ass. So Pun takes the nigga's phone and, like, rubs that shit up under his stomach and puts that shit back. So I'm dying. Money comes back. We just die, everybody laughing, you know what I'm saying? The niggas like, damn, where everybody laughing at? Bling, the niggas phone ring, yo, nigga grabs the phone, niggas like this talking, then that nigga just goes, yo, nigga made that, yo, that shit was just like the funniest shit in the world, man.
He had a lot of respect for me, man, you know what I'm saying? It was certain things he wouldn't do in front of me that he would do in front of other people, whatever the case may be, all the way around. He didn't even like hanging out with me, because he knew he couldn't do his crazy shit, like shoot fucking old ladies with water guns out his car and try to make people catch heart attacks throwing the M80s at him and shit. I wouldn't let him do that. So with me, I'm boring. I'm whack. Saying, yo, Joe, yo, Pun, we don't need a gun right now. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I got 4 right now. Yo, Pun, we don't need that right now.
He knew how to have fun, and we were laughing. But, like, his dark side, which was basically my whole, you know, it was more bad times than good times, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, the main reasons why I had all that jewelry and all them cars was because out of guilt. They were guilt gifts. I was basically a battered wife for 12 years.
Christopher was an abusive husband. He beat Liza. There's no other way to go around that. He treated her really poorly, which was amazing because I knew that he loved her. So it's so odd that she was his sun, his moon, and his stars, yet he abused her.
He wouldn't want me watching talk shows, because on talk shows they talk about cheating and they talk about abuse and talk about whatever. So for me not to get any ideas, you know what I'm saying? He didn't want to have no girlfriends because, you know, they bad influence or whatever. Say they want me to go into school because, you know, God forbid I get an education. I realize, you know, what the hell I'm doing with my life. You know, there's so much more I could do out there. You know what I'm saying? So he just tried to keep me, you know, in his palm of his hand. And he would do that a lot with fear. You know what I'm saying? By kicking my ass, putting fear into my heart.
I was there when a lot of things happened. You know what I'm saying? That I know my man wasn't, how could I put that carefully? Basically, you know, I was there. In incidents where I seen a lot of things I wish I haven't seen that also affected me, you know what I'm saying? Because I always remember, I was 18 years old, 19. You know, I'm still learning, you know what I'm saying, things about life. And, you know, but there was a lot of things that I seen that I didn't back them up on. My relationship as a friend is to just sit back, you know what I'm saying, and just be a friend. And I kicked the truth many times, and it wasn't something that was really for me to say. But after a while, it became something for me to say. He couldn't hold it back from me. You know, he couldn't say, yo, mind your business, because I've been there from the get-go, so I had to tell him. And the shit that he was ashamed of, you know, he was ashamed of, and he apologized, and he just didn't know sometimes what that anger came from.
The abuse got really bad. I mean, to this day, I thank God that I'm not dead, because I could have been. I've been hit, smacked, punched, gun clapped, you know, whatever. You know what I'm saying? You name it, I've been through it. He had, like, this real dark side, you know what I'm saying? And he would want to kill me. He would get upset, or whatever problems he had, or any pain that he had, anybody got upset, especially a lot of from his past, like with his mom and all that. So anything that he went through, I paid the price, basically. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, he would take it out on me because he knew I would always be there for him. I guess he knew I would always be there for him, that I would never leave him. I said I would always have his back. So I guess he felt safe. It's kind of weird, but he, like, felt safe that he could take out everything on me, but then wake up in the morning still know that I would have his back.
Like, Paul was the type of guy that he loved you, and he loved you to death. You know what I'm saying? So he would try anything to keep you with him, around him. So he did, you know, when he loved you, his love was so big that made him do... Sometimes, you know, stupid shit, you know, and, you know, it was just crazy, the relationship between him and Liza. You know, you look at Liza and be like, yo, Liza been through a lot of shit. You know what I'm saying? I don't know why the fuck she's still with him, but she stood with him. And Pun would be like, yo, I don't know why the fuck I'm still with her. And he stood with her. So it was that love that, like, you had to just respect from a distance and be like, fuck it, if she handles it, who the fuck am I to, you know, jump in and say, you know, that's not right?
She's a very strong woman. I think she did it because she loved him back. She took it because she loved him.
Liza did things for my grandson I don't think anybody else would do. She would do things for my grandson that I don't think I would have done for my husband in the same situation.
His children spent a month with me here in Florida while he was in the rehab in North Carolina. And my children do prayers every night, my own sons and daughters. So I had my nieces and nephew do the prayers also the month that they were here, every night. And every time we finish our prayers, I asked my kids to make a wish for something that they would like. And my kids always wish different things, to hit Lotto and, you know, silly things. But Vanessa made a wish that Poppy would stop hitting Mommy. And I started to cry, because what an awful wish for a little girl to have to make, right? So I told my brother I need to speak with him, and we went up to his room. At that point, he can still go up the stairs to his room, because at the end, he couldn't climb the stairs anymore. But at that point, he was, I would say, about 350, 400 maybe. And
He went up the stairs and we went to his bedroom. And I said, Christopher, listen to me. While the kids were with me in Florida, this happened, you know. And I want to talk to you about that. And he stopped me right there. And he said, let me stop you right there. And I said, what? He goes, I don't want to hear it. I've never hit my wife. I said, yes, you have. He said, no, that's a lie. My daughter would never say something like that. He called Vanessa upstairs. Now, of course, she's going to say I lied. he said, did you tell, you know, Titi Piña this? She said, no, Papi, I didn't. You see? You're the liar. You know, I'm like, so I looked at her like, you're not helping me. You're not making this easy on Titi. But I understand, you know, she's a child and she was afraid.
We was getting, everybody was ready, getting ready for to go on tour. We was going on tour in Texas. And his family was there, Piña was there, his grandmother, Piña's husband, Hector. Mach was there, his DJ, LaVar. Few cats, kids, Piña's kids. So he had this gat under the pillow that he was looking for. And I left it there, that's where I put it. So he was looking for the gat and he couldn't find it. I'm like, you know, it's there, I put it there. No, it's not here. So I'm like, I don't know where it's at. Oh, how do you know? You know, how is that you don't know where it's at? I'm like, I left it there. So it came out that someone had moved it, whether it been the grandmother or someone had moved it besides me, which I didn't know nothing about.
She misplaced something and it wasn't even her fault. It was actually my husband's fault. I don't even know if she knows that. There was something that Chris wanted and Liza put it in a certain place, but my husband felt that it was dangerous for it to be there. He saw it. So my husband moved it. Now, Chris asked Liza to go get this item, and it wasn't where Liza left. Chris is like, Liza, you better find it. You know, you better find it. You better find it. He was, you know, getting really irate, and she was getting very nervous. And to finally, my husband came up to me, thank God. And he was like, I know where, you know, what it is you're talking about. It's behind the bed. So yeah, I run and I tell Liza, Liza, you know, it's behind the bed. Hector moved it. So she ran to go get it, gives it to Chris, and Chris knocks her across the face with it.
And he just came and he swung at me and hit me with the gat in my face. And my eyes just went out. And it was closed shut. It was like so much pain. I felt like I got shot in my eye. I thought my eyeball came out. And I just grabbed it and I just screamed and I ran up the stairs. You know what I'm saying? And I went to the bathroom and Piña was there with the kids. And her little daughter, Rebecca, was crying. To this day, she still remembers. It's crazy.
I mean, just totally knocks her across the face with it. I ran up the stairs and I'm with all my nieces and my nephews and my kids. We were all in the house and we're all hugging each other. And all of a sudden, Liza's like dragging herself up the stairs and she's blood is gushing from her eyes. And I'm like, I'm screaming, you know, come up, you know, please. And I'm screaming, please, Liza, come up. He can't come up the stairs. He can't get you, you know, come up the stairs. And she's crawling up the stairs and, you know, and I grab her and I'm holding her against me and there's blood all over me. I mean, it was awful. It was really bad. And he's like, Piña, you better make her come down. You better make her come down. I'm like, no, I'm not making her come down. You want her, you come up and you come get her.
And then my eye fall out and she's like trying to look with the blood, but she can't really tell. And she's stressed and she's shaking. And then Chris is coming from downstairs screaming, what the fuck, you bitch, come down. All this shit, you are, whatever, whatever. And I'm just like stressed and I'm pacing and I was pacing upstairs, right? And in my room, I had this shotgun and I was about to load it and come downstairs and blast the nigga. That's my word. I was gonna blast him. Upstairs, I'm like, I come downstairs, nigga's gonna finish me off. You know what I'm saying? So I just got the courage to come downstairs. I came down and that was it. I came down the steps and he was like, you know, that's it, suck it up, you know what I'm saying? And just let's keep unpacking, let's go. I threw on some shades, I wiped my face. Everybody in the house was like this. Everybody started breaking out mad quick. Oh, let me go, you know, whatever, you know what I'm saying? Piña was still stressed, she was upset, she was arguing with him, you know, whatever. And he's, oh, mind your business, you know, mind your business, my wife, I do whatever I want, you know, that sort of shit. And I packed my shit and I bounced for a whole month on tour.
He did it in front of me, so he couldn't say anymore that he never hit Liza. I don't know if I want to say I learned from that point not to meddle anymore because I always ended up the loser. Because then Chris was mad at me. Liza went back anyway. You know, I'm like, hello. But you know, it didn't matter. Even if he got mad at me, the next day Chris was fine. Because he knew that I loved him. He wouldn't accept anyone hitting me. Never. If he even thought that my husband or my ex-husband laid a hand on me, my brother, I'm being honest, he would kill him. So why do you do it?
It's just crazy, but that's life. That's how shit is. It started when he got his money, that money from the lawsuit. When he got his money, then he was like, it was easy ride from there. Like, you know what I'm saying? He got his car, and he was just driving around. He was just on Mac mode, just chilling, driving around, you know what I'm saying? Checking niggas out in the hood. So he wasn't physically, you know, doing anything. He had problems growing up, you know what I'm saying? He had issues that he never resolved. And with him, his addiction was food. So if he was upset, he ate. If we was broke for a while and we just got dough, we mad happy, we would eat. If he was bored, he would eat. So everything was with the food. Like the first year of my marriage, I didn't even know how to cook. It used to be, you know, IHOPs for breakfast, it'd be Bennigan's for lunch, and it'd be Red Lobster for dinner. This was every day. So then the weight started escalating a little more. Not so much, little here and there, little two sizes. Oh, now he's a 40, now he's a 42, you know what I'm saying? You know, going to big and tall store, you know, the 2X, the 3X, you know, the 4X shirts, then it was the 5X shirts, and then it was the 6X shirts. Now after 6X, they don't make any more than 6X shirts and big and tall. So I'm buying the 6X shirts, and then I'm like stretching them out. I always do this thing with the shirt. If I had a shirt, I would show you. I take the shirt, you can put your sleeves, you put your hands up in the side up here, and you just stretch it out, and like through, put it around your back and just stretch the shirt out. So I had to stretch the shirt out. You know what I'm saying? And I will put my feet inside the shirt. This was a whole process for him to get dressed. I'll put my feet in the shirt, then I'll put it under my butt, and then stretch the shirt up this way and put my legs up to stretch to make it long. Because after I made it wide, now it's too wide, but now it's up to here. You know what I'm saying? So I had to make it long. So, you know.
It made us a little uncomfortable. We were like, you know, Chris, you got to lose weight. You know, why are you getting so weak? Oh, I'm all right. I'm all right. You know, I'm strong. You know, I'm this and that. I'm like, okay. But, what I saw when it was becoming pretty much an addiction or a sickness, what he had. We used to go out to McDonald's or Burger King. Chris loved fast food. And he had this thing that he always had to have Liza's last bite of food. No matter what they were eating, Liza could not eat the last bite of the meal. He had to eat it. So he had his own meal plus Liza's last bite, her last two fries, her last bite of the Big Mac, whatever it was, he had to have it. But that's everywhere now. Every restaurant they went to, every meal, his meal plus her last bite. I would say, Chris, you know, all her last bites add up, you're having like two extra meals a day.
There was times that he would eat a lot, but then there was a time in his life that he would just eat like a normal man, you know what I'm saying? Whether he had gland problems or, you know, I have no idea. I know he has heavy family on his mother's side, but like I said, he never checked himself in the hospital. He never used to, like, you know, the whole time that I was with him, the whole 10 years, he never went to a physical, he never went to the doctor, nothing like that, you know what I'm saying? It became a problem after a while. I remember after when he did the first album, he was on the first tour, he was heavy, but he also held his weight pretty good, because at 300, 400 pounds, he was still riding bike, he was still playing basketball, running around. And on his first album, he was maybe like 450 pounds, but he was on tour, he was running around, doing shows, illest shows, you know what I'm saying? Not a problem. And then towards the end of Capital Punishment and going into Yeah Baby, was like a period there that he wasn't really doing anything and he would just be home, you know what I'm saying? So from then he started getting a little heavier and heavier. And then from then, you know, he couldn't fit into no more big and tall clothes. Now I got Troy from 5001 Flavors, you know what I'm saying, doing his clothes. And it just got worse and just worse, and he would just get heavier. And after a time, you know, he knew there was time that he had to lose weight. And he went through his time that when he was like 400, 450 pounds, he would try to lose weight. He would go to the gym where he had his trainer, Mitch, and he would box. He would train there. And after he stopped that, when he got into the music, he couldn't really do the whole boxing thing as much. But then in the house, you know what I'm saying, he would talk about like how he wants to lose weight, and I'll go buy healthy food, and I wouldn't fry anything and bake, you know, the stuff. And he'll have me sit down with a list and a paper of a whole schedule, what time he's going to wake up. Everything was like to perfection. But then there come, you know, comes the next day, and say he wouldn't follow through with the plan.
He said he going on a diet. I walk in that house, I better not see no Chinese food. I better not see shit. And my wife admits to sneaking them food behind my back. You know, everyone did. You know, the old yo, he liked to eat. What the fuck? That made him happy. I used to give him chicken wings. I used to give him all that. I'm like, yo, what the fuck? Yo, when they almost beat him down over that shit. I'm like, what do you mean? Yeah, man, he used to like the waffles, man, with the this. I'm like, yo, it's incredible, man. You know what? What could you do, man? In this world, you just gotta try to find happiness, man.
When he used to go out with Joe on shows, and it was sometimes it would be hard for him to get dressed. And so without me being there, so I started realizing that it was gonna be a problem. And then as time escalated even more, it started getting worse. And then there was a time that he couldn't do anything for himself. He couldn't use a bathroom by himself. He couldn't take a bath by himself. He couldn't get dressed by himself. Couldn't clean himself by himself. I did everything. I was basically like a home nurse. It was like a job.
I was nervous, you know, I was nervous that he was gonna stop breathing because he was losing his breath in his sleep, you know? So that's when I started getting really worried, and I would tell Liza, you know, is he gonna choke? You know, and she's like, no, that's how he sleeps, you know, he's fine. But to her, what was normal to me was, you know, fear.
Pun came in the crib, and every place he went, he sat. It's like, and this is my first really time kicking it with him, and I was just like, I'm that kind of cat. You know, if I meet your man for the first time and he's high, I'm gonna go to somebody and say, yo man, your man's real high, you know? If I meet somebody, so I seen it, I'm like, yo, is he really carrying that weight okay, you know? They go, oh, yo, and I say, nah, just ain't right, you know? And then next time I seen him, it was like he was standing like on one foot and stuff. And I'm like, yo man, that ain't healthy.
Doing the Mr. Servon video shoot, that's when I had asked him, you know, came up, we had talked about the book thing. And before he can answer about him trying to write a book, he was standing up in pain, couldn't answer. But before he was about to answer, someone had left from the sofa that was about 10 feet away. When he saw that, his eyes opened, and the closest I've ever seen to Pun run was to that couch. Legs was hurting. Once he sat on that couch, whew, he answered any question.
You know, Pun was just talking. We was all in a group talking, and he just fell asleep. Like this is how we talking right now. Just like all of us, you know what I mean? Everybody, and he just fell asleep, and it scared me because I ain't never seen that shit. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I never seen that shit in nobody. Like, you know what I mean? Like, because he was, operating, like, yo, no. And then the next second, I was like, yo, Pun. And then he was just snoring and shit. And I was like, yo, I didn't know what it was, but I just knew it wasn't good. You know what I mean?
When we went out to the Grammys, he was calling doctors to find out how much it cost to do the stomach taping. And he wanted to do it. Family member of mine told him that it was dangerous. So he, you know, Chris was very paranoid to begin with of doctors, you know? So he totally changed his mind. I don't want to do it anymore. I don't want to do the stomach taping. So there went that out the window. I got upset with Chris because he didn't want to listen. So I went over his head and I called Steve Rifkin. And I told him, look, my brother is very overweight and I'm worried about him. I know you look at him as dollar signs, but he's my brother. And you guys better figure out a way for him to lose this weight because he's not listening to me. I can't afford to go and take him to the doctor, but you guys can. So you take some of that money that you're making from his album and you go pay and you get him to a doctor. I don't remember what Steve told me. I think he said, like, you know, Chris is a grown man, you know, and he knows what he can and cannot do or something. You know, I'm not sure exactly what his words were to me. Steve was a little sharp with me. Now, Christopher got upset, not with me, but with Steve for getting sharp with me. So he called Steve, and I don't know what he told him. But then the next day, Steve called me to tell me, look, we're going to put him in a doctor. You know, I apologize if I offended you in any way. I mean, Steve was very apologetic to me. I didn't mean to upset Steve, you know, and I didn't mean to upset Chris. You know, I had, like I said, goal. I just want my brother to get some help. And, you know, sometimes you have to step on some toes to get what you want. And, you know, I stepped on a few toes.
He was telling me, like, yo, Joe, man, I feel sick. Or, you know, my legs hurt or some shit like that. And I was just like, wow, this nigga's getting sick. So I would do anything for Pun, whatever he would want to do. So we forced him to go to North Carolina. He lost weight. He was looking good.
He went to a fat farm in North Carolina. He lost 80 pounds. He landed up visiting us here on a weekend trip and never went back. And that's the worst thing he did, because that's when he doubled all his weight.
Chris was a celebrity. He could get anybody to sneak him in some food, you know, and that's what Chris was doing for a while. So defeated the purpose. He went to North Carolina. He lost 100 pounds. He came out. He gained 300 pounds, you know, so it didn't work. He needed my mom to be a mom, you know? He needed to be nurtured, and Chris was never nurtured. And all that, after so many years, it just builds and builds and builds. And he was just full of anger and confusion. I think he was confused. He didn't understand why he was treated the way he was, why he was shunned out, why he wasn't given the love that he should have received as a growing child, you know? And all that built up in him. And I believe that's what made him so depressed to be, no, that's what made him eat the way that he did. Then as he ate so much and became so obese, that made him depressed. Because even though Chris was Big Pun and everybody loved him and he went out, there was so many things that he couldn't do because of his weight. He couldn't go to take his kids to an amusement park and get on the roller coasters and the rides with the kids. He couldn't do it. He couldn't go to an amusement park, period. I would tell him all the time, let's take the kids to Disney. He would say, okay, how am I supposed to walk around Disney? I say, no, they have those little motorized wheelchairs. Oh yeah, pun in a motorized wheelchair. How cool, you know? All that mentally affects you.
I kept telling him, oh, Chris, you're living my dream. You know, I always wanted to be on stage. I was always the one that was into the performing and, you know, and he goes, yeah, well, you're living my dream. And I'm like, what dream is that? You know, you're married, you have children. He's like, no, you're fit. You can walk, you can breathe, you know? And I think that was a real heartbreaking comment that he made to me. And I think that was kind of hard for him to admit.
God gave you a gift so you could give your children what you never had. And you're just throwing it away by eating KFC and buckets of hamburger. This doesn't make any sense, Chris. It doesn't make it. I would go there and make him salmon. I'll make him lettuce and tomatoes. And he would say, yeah, I'm going to eat what my will I make. I'm going to lose without losing weight. I'll give him apple juice. You know, things that I said is good for him. Then I go to bed early. So he knew that at 10 o'clock I was going upstairs and she's going out. I would come back down, download buckets of KFC and the hamburgers, and I would say, Christopher! And you know what? Under the pillow somewhere with the salmon or the tuna or whatever, under the... Oh, he was terrible. He was terrible. I never saw anybody eat like this.
I was dying to get Chris to go to a doctor because Chris was paranoid with doctors. I don't know what the fear was, but he was afraid of doctors. And I'm like, you know, my doctor's really cool, Chris. You know, you can go there. He's real cool. He's going to be down to earth with you. He's just, you know, going to take some blood and check you out. Nah. Come on. He's like, nah, but what if people see me going into the doctor's office? You know, people are going to automatically assume I'm sick, and then they're going to write in the magazines that I'm sick. And I'm like, all right, there's got to be a way around this. I call my doctor. You know, I want you to see my brother. You know, is there a way we could get him in there without anyone seeing him? He said, sure, bring him in through the back.
And he comes in through the back door and he's in the parking lot, and I open up the back door. He's sitting there, he's leaning on a car, having trouble breathing, and I see this massive person. He must have been like 700 pounds plus, massive. Having difficulty breathing, really, having shortness of breath. I immediately saw that. Very apprehensive coming in.
He went in, sat down, Dr. Hirschman just, whoa, you know, when he saw Chris, he was like, he couldn't believe how big Chris was. You know, he thought I was exaggerating, you know, I guess. I'm like, my brother's really big, you need to help him, you know. But he heard me, but he didn't realize it until he saw Christopher.
This is a guy who is completely out of control, eating terrible lifestyle, staying up all night, not sleeping, eating tremendous quantities of food. And I had to really, really scare him, but in a nice way. And I scared everyone around him about this is a serious problem. We have a very sick person here who can die at any minute. To see that, and really a person that was truly alone with this and not being able to really have the power to change it or to focus in on that and do what it took to get better. As a doctor, it's literally pitiful. As sure as I'm standing here, it's gonna happen.
I'm glad we went, you know, because if Chris, you know, if that gave Chris another year with me and with the kids, you know, and everybody, then I appreciated every second, every minute that I had more with Christopher. I appreciated it. And if those pills and that doctor and those blood tests gave me that extra year that he lived, it was worth it to me.
Sometimes we'll stay here for 2-3 days, then go to the studio, stay there in Sony's studio in the basement for 2-3 days, then come back up here. And when he was in the studio, he was basically working. And when he came back up here, it was just, you know, 2-3 days out of the rest, him catching up on the writing, try to go down to the pool so he could work out. He liked being in the pool because, you know, you feel light. You know, if you're a heavy person and you're in the pool, you know, you can do anything in the pool. You feel light. You don't feel your weight. So he always just said, I love being in the pool because I don't feel my weight. I feel normal. You know what I'm saying? I can run around. I can jump. You know what I'm saying?
I told him, Christopher, I'm going to go across him and buy the kids some things at the Toys R Us because the hotel had a tunnel that connected to a mall. He didn't want to let me leave at all. It was just so odd. He goes, no, don't go to Toys R Us. I said, I want to buy the kids some presents. No, stay with me. Don't leave me. I'm like, okay. I said, well, I'm going to go downstairs and get them some candy from the lobby. No. Send Liza. Send somebody else. Don't go. Reef. You know, Carlos, call anybody to go down. Don't leave me. I'm like, you are weird today, you know? So we started talking about his weight, and he said, Pina, tell me something. He goes, you think that stomach stapling thing, you think it really works? And I said, yes! You know, I couldn't believe he brought it up again. I was like, yes, yes! He goes, I think I want to do it. And I said, well, Chris, I'll do everything I got to do. I'll call the doctors tomorrow, you know, when I on Monday when I get back. I'll call the doctors. I'll figure out where, you know, what you got to do, how much it costs, and we'll do this. I said, you come and stay in Florida? He goes, yeah, I'll come and stay in Florida. I'll come and stay with you. He goes, you're going to take care of me, though, right? I said, I'll take care of you. I do everything I got to do. What do I have to do? He goes, no, I'm just saying, you're going to help me through it if I do it. I said, I will do anything I have to help you through this. We're going to do this. He said, we're going to do this. So he says, I don't want to sleep tonight. I want to stay up all night. You know, he says, let's go to the pool. I said, my flight leaves at 6 a.m. I'm going to sleep. He said, no, let's go to the pool. We went to the swimming pool, me, him, Liza, the kids. He sent for Liza to get her brother, to have her brother come down to the hotel. He was just very weird that night. He got in the pool. He played with Rebecca. He was throwing her back and forth. He played with Heather. He was having the best time.
That weekend, I had spoke to him, and I said, you know, this is really ridiculous. You know, you got to get checked in the hospital, you know what I'm saying? And he just begged me. He was like, you know, let me just do these 3 more songs. I got 3 more songs I got to do. I'm saying, once I'm done with that, you know, you can send me wherever, anywhere, you know, I'll do whatever. So I was like, all right.
I was on the computer looking for information on stomach stapling. I got several different doctors' names. I got places like Fat Farm type places where you go and you actually stay there. I mean, I drew up all this information. I even called my job that day and said that I wasn't coming into work. And I called Liza. It was around 9 a.m. now. And I said, Liza, I got enough for me. I said, you know, wake up Chris. She says, no, he's tired. You know, he's sleepy. He doesn't want to get up. I said, all right, well, call me when he gets up. She called me at around 11. She said, Pina, look, you know, your brother, he's having trouble breathing. You know, your brother hates water. And he's asked me for like about 8 glasses of water. She goes, I don't know what's wrong with him. I said, well, Liza, call the doctor, you know, to see if the doctor could come to the hotel. She said that she did, but that the doctor was on vacation, or something. The doctor couldn't come. And I'm like, oh my God. I said, well, you know, what are you gonna do? She goes, well, let's just wait a little while. You know, I'm gonna give him the water. Maybe it'll go away. I said, all right, Liza, well, let me know.
Something was kind of weird. I felt that something was going to happen. And I had called my assistant, and I told him, I said, listen, it was around 2 o'clock, 1:30, 2 o'clock. I told him, I said, don't even bring my kids here because I know something's going to go down, and I'm not sure what it is. So, you know, I'd rather you take them to my mother's house because I know my brother's there.
So she calls me. She's like, yo, this nigga ain't doing too good. Reef went to go get the kids, so I'm gonna have Reef drop off the kids by your crib, and then he's gonna shoot back up here. She was like, you know, this nigga don't want me to call an ambulance, but I called an ambulance because it looks, you know, I'm scared. So I was like, all right, you know, just, I'm here, don't worry about it, you know, so just call me, you know, everything's gonna be all right.
I leaned his head back, and I tried to see if I could give him CPR or something. His head was right here, but it was like his tongue was sticking out so much. And he had like so much saliva, and it was like, you know, I couldn't do it. So then I came and I grabbed him and I picked him up, and he was just still shaking, still shaking. And I just grabbed him And, you know, for that minute, you know, I was like, oh, my God, you know, I'm losing my husband. He's dying on me. You know what I'm saying? And it's like his whole life flashed in front of my eyes. I just, like, saw everything from the beginning to the end, everything that we've been through, everything that we've gone through. And it was just, like, a real weird feeling. I called Joe. I had the phone in this hand. And then I had my other hand on his, by his phone. And I'm telling Joe, yo, you got to come down here, you know, right away, you know, there's some shit going on right here. So he's like, right away. So he hung up the phone. And right when I hung up the phone, his pulse, I didn't feel nothing on his neck. He had no pulse. And like 2-3 seconds later, the paramedics came. Basically, I gave him their space, you know what I'm saying, like 15, 20 minutes.
5 minutes later, the kids come. So it's like, yeah, what's up, kid? Help me, yo. Hey, here, watch TV. Boom, it was like 3 o'clock already. The kids coming out of school. So they watch the TV. Boom, the phone rings again. Alan calls me. I come over. She's like, yo, fucking ambulance here. This nigga stop breathing. She was like, yo, he's not breathing. You know, they working on him. I'm like, I'm bugging. But then I got to go back to the kids, and everything's gravy, you know. Well, mommy and daddy be here in a little while.
At this point, they came and they brought a dolly, because that's what they had to bring him out in. And I'm running around from this room, and I have my kids' room next door here, and I'm bringing them sheets and a whole bunch of sheets and blankets so that they could tie his hands, and they tied his legs together because he was really wide. While they lifted him up, I'm holding his head. They lift him on the dolly. They place him there. I get a pillow shoved in under his head. And from there, they just rolled him out all through the front, went up the elevator, down the back, out the pool. Once we got to the side of the building, the ambulance was there, so the guy was taking out the bed that's already in there, you know, the metal pieces. They were emptying out the ambulance so they could put the dolly up in there. And from there, I just went, I really broke down. I just started crying, and I prayed so hard to God, like, please, just let this, you know, just let this, you know, that he comes out of this. So at this point, the doctor comes in, and she sits down, and she says, oh, Miss Rios, I'm sorry. At this point, I started crying and screaming. I told her my life story like in 2 minutes. I was like, oh, my God, I've been married with him like for so long. You know what I'm saying? I've been with him since I was 14. I just went through the whole thing, my 3 kids. And it was just like crazy. It was just really crazy. And to go back there where he was at, they opened up the curtains, and he's just sitting there, just laying there on a dolly in the middle of the room, real low to the ground. And I just sat there, and I just held him, and I kissed him, and I cried, and he still felt warm, and I was just like, I couldn't believe that, you know, that it was ending this way, you know what I'm saying?
I took the phone, I said, Liza, you know, what's going on? Is he in the hospital? Is he okay? She said, Bina, he didn't make it. And I said, what do you mean he didn't make it? He didn't make it to the hospital? You know, is he in the hotel? She said, he didn't make it. You know, your brother died. He didn't make it. And I can't explain to you what that felt like. It was like a building fell on me. I can't explain it. My whole world collapsed because my brother was the center of my life at that moment. He was, I looked at my brother as strength, as, you know, nothing could tear him down. You know, why was this happening? I said, it can't be. I was just there yesterday. Liza, I just left. I was just there. She said, I know. I know, Pina, I know. I said, I can't. I just started screaming. I threw the phone to the floor. But you know what? Then Liza said, you need to call your family and let them know. I'm like, I had 30 seconds to grieve for my brother before I had to become now the family, you know. I had to let everyone, I had to call my grandmother, I had to call my mother and tell her that her son died. I had to call my uncles, I had to call my sisters and my, you know, I had to call everyone. So I had 30 seconds to bang my head against the window, because that's what I did. I went to my sliding glass door and I just didn't want to believe it. Then I got the phone and I called my mom. My mom didn't believe me.
And I stood with the phone in my hand, just staring at the phone, just like in shock and in a daze, like praying, God, don't let it be happening now. You know, it's too soon. My son cannot leave me yet. You know, he's got so much going for him, and he's, you know.
I'm used to young people dying by getting shot. You know, a lot of my friends died, you know, by getting shot, killed, or accident. You know, I never seen a young nigga die because he was fat. You know what I'm saying?
Shit, you know, broke my fucking heart. Shit just broke my shit. You know, Gil, went to see him. My dad was laying down right there. And we just, I cried my ass off, running. And I apologize for everything. And I love him to death. You know what I'm saying? That's my brother.
So, no matter how fat Pun was, we didn't think he was gonna die.
After he passed away, it was about a week that I just stood by myself. My three kids, I had three people appointed in the family that they were taking charge of each child. That night when we was in Cuban's house, Jimmy was there from Jimmy's Bronx Cafe. He was the one that made all the arrangements, you know what I'm saying, for the funeral. I didn't have to do anything. I just said that the way he wanted, that he wanted to be cremated. And for his clothing, they had his designer, which is Troy from 5001, you know, do his outfit. And basically all I had to do was give them a list of who was coming down from his side of the family, like from Florida. It was his sisters, you know, his mother, his grandmother. That's basically it. And Jimmy, he took care of everything. It was at the Ortiz Funeral Home right there on Westchester Avenue in the Bronx. I went in my truck. They had a limo there for me, but I was like, you know, I'm rolling in my truck. And I had my kids with me, and I had my family behind in the limo. We got there. It was already crowds of people, cameras, a lot of reporters. Police. It was a weird feeling because, you know, I'm here, you know, I don't know how I'm going to react to see my husband, you know, laying there. And when I got there, I didn't even think about it. It was just so many people, so much commotion going on. I felt like mad pressure. Reporters trying to get a comment, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, yo, these people better stay out of my face, you know, for real, you know what I'm saying?
When I got there, I just couldn't believe the amount of people that I saw out there. I mean, lines and blocks of people.
One kid came in and took off his shirt and threw himself down and started praying to Chris. And I'm like, who's this kid, you know? He gets up and I said, you know, where did you know my brother? He said, I never met your brother. He inspired me. What he did, everything he accomplished, you know, he says, he gave a lot of us hope, a lot of us from the Bronx that, you know, don't think we could do it. I think I can do it. Everybody loved him so much.
The most impressive thing about it wasn't the A-list. It wasn't the A-list celebrities and all the celebrities that came by. It was how the fans, man, I can't even describe how much of the street they took. It just went around, police barricading, just shit. Must have been a good three avenues worth. Not three blocks, three avenues. That would be about six blocks of just all around.
Once again, it was my job to protect Pun, to make him look the best, to give him whatever he wanted. We didn't only put him in the funeral home, we rented the whole fucking funeral home, like every room. You know how there's four different funeral rooms? There was one for refreshments, there was one for flowers.
It was just, you know, very emotional, man, very. People crying over his casket. I mean, pain. Every member of Terror Squad had a tear in their eye. I can tell you that much. Every member. Whether it be friend or foe, whoever it was, whoever went, whoever passed by, walked by the casket. We made like an orderly procession of it. We didn't want anything to be said that it was a mockery. That's why we made sure through Jimmy's and, you know, Mr. Rodriguez and his family and our friends, and we made sure that even our security staff from Jimmy's Bronze Cafe worked that event, and we held it down so they couldn't, that no one could say anything like, oh, this such and such a thing happened at Pun's funeral. No, nothing. It was clean, beautiful, and it went perfect.
The funeral was really weird. It was like you get a lot of mixed emotions.
because I understand that he was Big Pun and he was famous and people loved him and they admired him, especially in the Bronx. We all grew up in the Bronx and he refused to leave. He said, this is my home, this is where I'm staying. And you know, he was born there, he was raised there, he died there, and he was buried there. It's like you want to go in there and you want to be with the family and you want to grieve and you want to mourn, but then at the same time, the way they had everything set up, it was like a museum. And at times, I had very mixed emotions about it, because people were coming in and, you know, they had the ropes around it and everybody's looking at him like it was King Tut's tomb or something. You know, I'm like, this is my brother. This is a person. This is not a display.
It was more of a spectacle, because we believe in going to church. And on the way to the cemetery for your last rites, we believe in having a Catholic priest there. We didn't have that. We would not ask. We would totally ignore. I stood in a corner with my family, and it was like we were not part of what was going on. The day that we're going to the cremation, we go slow. We go slow. We go by his block to give the people the last look where he came from. None of that was done. I don't know who it was, but we got to the car was going, the limo was going maybe 80 miles an hour. I never saw anything like this in my whole life. It was just completely disorganized. But I also say young people don't bury young every day. They were probably trying to do it their way. It was incorrect, but that was their way. The only thing I complain is that we were never asked, what would you like? Because everybody that went to that funeral, his family, non-fat, everybody loved Pun. But nobody loved him more than me.
You know, you got some of the family don't like the other half of the family, and this, we had to put up with it. But most of all, it went smooth, man. A lot of things happened with Pun that a lot of other people wouldn't let happen. Like, you know, we let the public come through, his fans, you know, come through and see him and show him love, and so many flowers, so many people, you know, the weirdest people, you know, the Whitney Houston, Eminem's, Cypress Hills must have sent 40 flowers, like different shits. Like, they love Pun. He was truly missed. He was loved. Everybody came to the funeral. Everybody from Puff Daddy, Little Kim, and they whole crew, to LL. Mac 10 flew from LA, the Lox, the whole Rough Riders, fucking Wyclef did like some singing, the Maria dudes, Bone Thugs was there. I mean, everyone you can name came through to send their support for Pun. It's crazy. And I still remember telling them, like, you know, the day before they cremated him, or that last night, you know, I was just like, damn, man, this is our last dance. You know what I'm saying? It's over for us. We're not here no more.
My life with him was very loving, and he gave me so much, but yet he gave me a lot of hell. And him dying, you know, part of me died, but then it's like part of me started to live again. Like, it was the end of one part of my life, but it was the beginning of another. And it was the worst day of my life, because I was losing my friend. I was losing the father of my kids. You know, it was the first man I ever been with in my life, with, you know, my first boyfriend, the first guy I had sex with. I just didn't know how I was gonna, I know I'll make it, I know I'll survive, because I survived so much already, you know, what I went through for 10 years, and I made it on my own. But it was just like, how someone could just be there. The night before, I was just sleeping, you know, in this room with him. And from one second to another, he's gone. That's it. You know, I'm never going to see him again. I'm never going to hear him again. It was like the worst day. It was the best day of my life, because I felt such a burden lifted from my shoulders. You know what I'm saying? Because my relationship with him got up to a point that I didn't know who I was anymore. I wasn't happy. It was hard, because I was carrying my own weight and I had to carry his weight. I had to be strong for myself, and I had to be strong for him, you know, and no one was there for me, you know what I'm saying? So, and just the fact of being a battered wife and trying to fight for my identity and my freedom. And I didn't, you know, it was a lot of things that went on with the marriage. And it was like the best day of my life because I didn't have to deal with that no more. It was over. You know, because even if he survived and we would have broke up, he still would have gave me hell. I still wouldn't have been able to, you know, get on with my life, or he still would have been there, you know. There was no way that he would have been alive and would have been separated. We always would have been together. But the only way I felt that I could go on with my life, and he knew it too, was the only way if he wouldn't be here. You know, so like I said, you know, it was the worst day because, you know, never I thought, you know, I had to face the fact that he won't be here. He won't be here to raise my kids, to raise our kids. You know what I'm saying? He's not going to walk my daughters down the aisle or speak to my son about, you know, the first time him having sex or, you know, things like that. But it's the best day of my life, too, because it's like he put me through so much drama and I experienced so many things behind him that I'm just glad it's all over.
You can catch me in the cherry red one.
Every day you wish you had him. There ain't too many people like him. I'm pretty sure a lot of people feel that way.
Trying to cruise through the avenue while my people's just popping bottles up in sewers. My neighbor fucked that. Spun the UE, lost the hubcaps, back to the shack. Came back in a what's that?
How much I love him and how deeply sorry I am that things were not different, but that could we at least be mother and son for that day and love each other totally for that day.
I was really fortunate, really happy and proud and actually blessed that I was able to even know someone like him.
You know, we sit around and he just tell jokes and play tricks on me like he used to. He put sugar in my rice, or pepper in my soda, you know. He do bad things to me. But I wouldn't mind those for a few minutes. I miss them.
Somebody stop me, never that. Where my niggas at? Uptown, uptown. You know you're feeling that cash room. Hardcore, you can dance to.
How could there be another pun? Like, who can replace him? He's a legend. Who can replace him? That'll never happen.
I ain't even probably the best there is since alive. Tell a squad, nigga, stop sleeping. What you say your name was again? And I know you from where? Elementary school. Niggas wanna be like us.
I don't know you,
but they
man.
Don't bust fingers, and it's so hard.
Money, not you again. Go that way.
Niggas wanna fuck my wife.
Loser.
Niggas wanna take my life, but it's so hard.
Yeah, you ain't fucking my wife. You taking my life. And if you just ain't, just won't.